So the question often comes up, what rifle do I need to preserve the liberty of our country in troublous times? There's lots of different options out there. Of course, there's all the different tactical rifles. You've got long-range precision rifles that we spend a lot of time on in this particular series. But to preserve one's liberty, maybe you need to look no further than what's right under your nose in your own gun closet.
We've got another letter from Stanley. He writes in today saying that, Rex, I am concerned about the direction our country is heading. Currently, I only have a .22 rifle. What do I need to preserve the liberty of our nation?
Preserving the liberty of the nation, that's a tall order. That's a huge responsibility. That's also one of the things that we had been instructed by the founding fathers to actually be charged with doing. Everyone in the country was assumed to have to be relatively equipped to be a good, productive member of the nation, to be able to defend our country, you know, in case we're invaded or in case a tyrannical regime would threaten the liberty of the people. That's from a historical context. I'm not saying we're there yet, but historically, that's one thing that a lot of countries had to deal with. And you look like you want to say something, Casey.
Well, it just makes me think of a quote from a video I actually watched just the other day, recommended by Rex. But the lady was talking about World War II and the taking over of the Austrian government. And she said that liberty is when the government fears the people, and tyranny is when the people fear the government.
Yep, and that's unfortunately a state that a lot of people are almost bordering on even today, maybe. And so people see something coming and they're worried about it and they want to participate in the liberty preservation mechanism, which is being a firearms owner that is proficient. And really, ideally, what would happen is if everyone's proficient enough and well-armed enough, like certain countries are across the world, Switzerland's a good example, they haven't been in a war in 600 years. They have been very well equipped. They're relatively laid back. They're very nationalistic in a lot of ways. They love being Swiss, and I respect the Swiss people. I know some of them. I got to go over there and do some reviews from Switzerland talking about their gun situation, and I got to shoot the SIG 551, you know, and the K31s over in Switzerland. They're awesome people. But it's true that if you look at demographically, you get a culture of people who are good people, God-fearing people. That's why we put the Bible studies in the Rex Reviews podcast, because I am obligated to do so. Because if you're just running around with a firearm to protect yourself and you're a bad person, then it's really not helping the whole world situation out that much. So, but no, preserving liberty is a huge responsibility. So that's why the firearms culture in America is exploding. Everyone I know who hasn't been a firearms person who has now decided they are buying guns. And that's why you see gun sales, record sales through the roof. Obama's the greatest gun salesman in history as far as scaring people into buying guns. And likewise, we see the Hildebeest coming around the corner and people are saying, holy Moses, I need more ammo, because they're scared. They don't know what's happening. They feel uneasy. So whatever the political climate, it's always a little scary, you know. Preserving liberty is something that everyone feels like they need to do, and that's actually where these people are buying guns for. They're not buying these guns for hunting, folks. I'm not trying to scare anyone or break the news. It's just a fact. The people who I know who haven't been a gun owner before are buying them in the last couple of years, are buying them for home defense. They're buying them because they want to survive. So that being said, a lot of people, and I was just talking with one of my rancher friends the other day, a really cool guy, but he's got a whole mess of kids and they're awesome. He's got an awesome family to take care of, and he's an awesome dude. And he doesn't have like a lot of coin to burn on frivolous things. So he wants to get straight to the point. He doesn't want to screw on. He doesn't want to spend $10,000 on some Turbomatic 5000 sniper weapon system with laser pointer and propeller on the side. And you know what I'm saying? Unfortunately, because we got so enthusiastic about the series, we talk so much about all the cool equipment out there. Because, I mean, that's kind of our thing. We like to really get to the extreme long range precision shooting, because that's the most effective application of that kind of fire, is to get the most out of your rifle. But you don't need to really honestly have that much stuff to probably fulfill that role of preserving liberty, because all you need to do is have a deterrent, really, for bad people to take over the system and maybe do bad things. And that's the whole point of the Second Amendment, is a deterrent. It's not really meant to be even used. Now, the point is to deter it from even starting, kind of like mutually assured destruction with nuclear weapons. The point is to not use them. Sometimes it don't work out that way, unfortunately. But so here we are with the question.
So when it comes to civil defense, somebody who's looking to just get started, what would be an appropriate setup?
Well, it's you'd be surprised, man. I would tell the guy, if he's looking for something to preserve the liberty of the country and help just really defend the ranch or something, look in your gun closet and tell me what you got in there. If you've got a gun already, it's probably going to, if it's in operating condition where it shoots straight, it's not damaged, it's going to work fine to a certain level, right? But for the applications of really enhancing that with the cheapest amount of money possible, I would actually say, man, that like the standard deer hunting rifle or even varmint hunting bolt action rifle, a center fire bolt action rifle that's not broke, that operates reliably, you can get them for $200, $100 if you get with a Russian military Mosin Nagant or something. Dude, like you can really cover a lot of ground with just a rifle. You don't even need a scope. Simo Heha was the most effective sniper in history. He had what many of the modern tactical gurus online would consider to be the biggest POS in history in terms of rifles. He had a M91 from 1891. That's when this rifle was designed. He was a Finnish sniper in the Winter War when Russia invaded, and they had those bolt actions from the 1890s. The Mosins. And he racked up 505 confirmed kills just in that one winter because he just employed sneaky guy techniques and aiming techniques. And he helped defend his country, Finland, from being invaded by the Russians, man. So he was kind of a war hero, and he had open sights. He had a pocket full of ammo, and he had really good winter clothes because it's cold up there. And he just he defended the liberty of his country just with that.
So what about the people who don't really have a lot of skill with guns and they just want something to protect themselves? Maybe they'll never use it, but they want something that's pretty much going to take care of itself, that they don't have to do a lot of work with.
Okay, that's a really good question. And then this, we can do a multifaceted approach here. So defensive firearms, okay? For defending the home against imminent attack, if you are not familiar with firearms, I would say a shotgun. Probably a pump shotgun would be fine. It doesn't take a lot of training to figure out how to operate one of those, although you still need to go out and train with it because there's idiosyncrasies with a tube-fed shotgun. You don't want to think you unloaded it and you actually loaded it and then you shoot the fridge in the garage. I mean, that happens. You know what I mean? So like a 12-gauge or a 20-gauge shotgun, if it's a woman or someone who might be concerned about recoil, a 20-gauge is totally fine. Just get like the number 4 buckshot and you are set. Get a bunch of boxes of the number 4 buckshot. You can buy a shotgun for $190. Don't cut the barrel down shorter than 18 inches. Stay within your laws. But a more compact size, like an 18 or 20 inch barrel on a shotgun, is probably ideal. You can get combat configuration Mossberg shotguns or the Maverick 88 for $199, $200. That's the best home defense or urban defense gun. If you live in a city or an apartment building, or if you have, you're just worried about defending your family from imminent danger, guys like within point blank range, 0 to 50 yards trying to kill you, a shotgun with buckshot is by far the most quick, easy, cheap way to accomplish that goal. You're going to be a handful if you have that thing next to your bed at night if some bad guys want to come in there and get you. Now, when you're talking about handguns, if you're a new shooter, I would not recommend the use of a handgun for defensive unless you're going to carry it on your person. But that requires training. You should not buy a handgun unless you plan on shooting it and operating it a lot. You need to shoot at least 1,000 rounds out of a handgun before you even have a clue what's going on, really. And so that's my opinion on handguns. Shotgun, it's the same deal. You want to shoot it as much as you can. But the handguns require a higher level of training, in my opinion. They're just harder to handle effectively for any kind of scenarios to to clear jams, make sure you're going to hold it properly, flash sight picture aiming, all that stuff. It requires maybe more work. Now, in terms of ranch defense, preserving liberty, to get back to the original question, ranchers, a lot of ranchers like this friend of mine, he's the rancher guy, asking, well, what do I need? Like, what do I need to buy? I'm like, dude, what do you got? He tells me about a bolt action rifle with a 3-9 hunting scope, some Bushnell or some cheap hunting scope for $50. That will probably work way better than you need it to work. Like we said earlier, Simo Heha held off a decent amount of the Russian army. They had machine guns and tanks, and he basically made quite a statement there with a bolt-action rifle with no scope. And you can buy a Mosin Nagant for $100 in the United States, and you can buy ammo for cheaper than that. So that's fine. You're going to have to learn how to shoot. You know, you're going to have to learn how to shoot that rifle. That's probably the thing I would recommend is people, whatever you got in the closet, if you don't have a deer rifle in the closet, get a deer rifle. Get a bolt action, a scope, something cheap. You don't need an AR-15 really to preserve liberty. That's more of a defensive weapon by nature, honestly, or a fire suppression weapon in the terms of combat applications. But unless you're being resupplied by army like ammo specialists and stuff, you don't really want to burn off that many rounds.
What about like a Red Dawn situation?
The Red Dawn situation, what would be effective for that? Actually, what we currently have on every ranch in the United States, at least in this part of the world. So if you're on the sunny beach in California, maybe a lot of people don't have a deer rifle around here. But if you're maybe up in the center part of the country, in the flyover country, or the ranching culture out in the bush there, people have deer rifles. Pretty much every house probably has one out there. That's going to be very effective for deterring a Red Dawn invasion. That's going to be way more effective than a bunch of cowboys running around with ARs or FALs or SCAR 17s or all these high-end assault rifles. That stuff is great too in its proper application, but that's really a different deal. If I was an invading army, I would fear a bunch of angry deer hunters with scoped rifles hiding that are going to take one or two shots at my guys and then escape and evade, because there ain't no fighting against that. What are you going to do? I mean, if you look historical examples, dude, besides Simo Heha, and even the Russians did it when the Germans tried to invade in Russia there, and they took Stalingrad and some of these huge battles. The employment of snipers was an incredible deterrent against an overwhelmingly technologically superior army that was invading. You can't fight helicopters and stuff in that regard. If you're going to be defending the nation from the Russians or the Chinese when they invade, a scoped bolt-action deer hunting rifle, lightweight, get a rattle can, spray paint it, maybe get a bipod so you can have artificial support that's handy in the field so you can get a good steady shooting position so that when you lay down in the tree row to take out them evil Russian army invading guys or whatever they're doing, you're going to be pretty well equipped to do that with a deer rifle. Any center fire deer rifle, you're going to be able to reach out to 300 meters without any kind of special equipment. That's incredibly effective. I mean, most of your military snipers are engaging at that distance anyways already. If you're beyond that distance, it's already kind of especially on animate targets. Honestly, you probably won't take the shot on a patrolling group of guys unless you're really, really skilled. 300 meters is probably going to be your max range anyways. So 300 is plenty far enough for you to remain completely concealed and still effectively engage enemy troops invading. I know that if you talk to a lot of the people who fought in Afghanistan, both on the Russian side and on the American side, they weren't really concerned with the idiots running around with Kalashnikovs just rattling rounds off all over the place. That would just give away their position. What they were worried about is those guys with the old Enfield rifles, the old bolt-action World War II surplus rifles laying all over there. Because those guys understood they had one shot at a time. And they understood that there was these things called sights on the rifle. And they would aim. And the Russian soldiers who invaded Afghanistan in the 80s who made that mistake, and the American guys who made the mistake in our day, just constantly being harassed by these guys over there. It's a very hard one to weed out because the gun is so prolific. It's everywhere on the face of the earth, the bolt action rifle. And it's plenty deadly out to a range that you can basically put off an enemy for a almost undetermined amount of time if you can just employ escape and evasion. So a bolt action rifle, man, is probably the ticket. That's the most cost effective way. Whatever you got in the closet, get ammo for it. Make sure you know how to use it properly. Practice shooting as you would fight. So if you get a bipod on there, you're set. You got a rifle scope, that's even better. I mean, a 3-9 hunting scope will be plenty good, probably out to 400 and 500 yards with maybe a bigger cartridge, you know? So that's probably your most effective way to go.
Any logistical differences between a bolt action versus something that's semi-automatic?
In terms of effectiveness on the battlefield or?
Lots of different facets, I guess, whether it's ease of use or durability.
A bolt action is very simple. It's going to be easiest to maintain. It's going to be easiest probably for a normal person to use and operate. Everyone pretty much already knows how to operate them. It's one at a time. You are going to have to be disciplined in your fire. You're going to have to aim when you shoot. But that's one of the things about a bolt action, too, is it causes you to have to slow down to aim. Semi-automatic kind of subconsciously encourages people to shoot a lot because you have all those rounds at your expenditure that you can shoot. And that's not always maybe the best idea, especially if you're not going to be resupplied in a ongoing SHTF scenario where the world just done got unraveled. And you run out of ammo in the first day, and you're not really sitting all that good. So actually, a .22 rifle is an excellent way to survive. If you could only have one rifle for a poop hit the fan scenario, what's going to happen is a .22 rifle with a pocket full of .22 shells is probably going to be your best option because you got unlimited ammo compared to the next guy lugging around all that junk. Because you're not only going to be carrying your weapons, you're going to be carrying everything else you're going to need to live, your clothes, your soap, your food, whatever you got. So yeah, bolt action's a good way to go. A semi-automatic rifle is really a combat person's weapon. So if you're in a static position or location where you're going to be defending a certain area with a group of guys, or if you're going to be planning on engaging in offensive combat in such a way to where you're going to actually try to clear out all these guys from a certain deal at one time, then you'd use standard infantry tactics and strategy there. And that might find more use for like a semi-automatic rifle. So AR-15s, AKs, FALs, that whole category of rifles there is going to be more effective in that sense. But just for deterring potential invasion or even preserving the liberty, probably the most bang for the buck by far is a bolt action rifle being aimed. Because you only need to shoot one round. If it hits what it's going, you just done psychologically paralyzed a whole company of guys for the next few hours where they try to figure out where it came from. They don't know what happened. They know that someone aimed. They don't like the idea of being in someone's crosshairs. And so that's, I know that the snipers in the Ireland conflict, when the British Army had to go up into North Ireland and try to simmer down that situation, there was only a small handful of guys that held off like a huge portion of the British Army. And likewise, if you look at the War of Independence, even that's the same tactic going on there, is you just had some hicks out in the bush with their rifles and they aimed and they took on a whole army very effectively just through what they call asymmetrical warfare practices. You don't want to get drawn into a firefight with an army unless you can produce superior firepower. So why engage in a battle you can't win? So if they got 30 guys with automatic weapons and you got 6 guys with automatic weapons, why even start that one? Because it's a war of attrition. You're going to lose. Because if you're in a firefight, if it's a contest of who can shoot the most to finally hit you, going to lose. So you engage in what they call asymmetrical warfare, which is let's just not play by those rules at all. How about your guns are useless because you don't even know where I'm at? You're just shooting every direction. And then when the Russians are invading, like in Red Dawn, and Patrick Swayze had his bolt action deer rifle there, that's probably a really good way to go.
So Stan writing in here probably doesn't need the $10,000 Stipermatic turbo with a propeller on the side then.
No, that's really a special purpose weapon, to be honest. And it's my thing that I do. I like it. So it's fun for me. And for the people watching the Rex Reviews Sniper 101, it's a lot of fun to push that out and to really get the... That level of equipment is really needed to extract the maximum potential out of a cartridge. So if you got like a 300 Win Mag, okay, well, if you want to get that maximum potential of the cartridge and be able to hit stuff at 1,000 or 1,200 or 1,500 meters, yeah, now you do need specialized equipment. Now you're in that realm of you have to spend at least $300 and get that SWFA Super Sniper scope for cheap, right? So you can get into a decent extreme range precision shooting rifle for even $1,000. Spend $500 on a nice Magnum rifle or a flat shooting cartridge that's set up decent and get a bipod. Get an SWFA-10 power scope on there. You got yourself a long-range precision rifle. But for all practical purposes, for all practical sniper purposes, snipers don't necessarily engage in long-range precision shooting all the time. They don't have to be at the farthest possible distance. That is a tool in the tackle box that can help you accomplish a goal if you're in a less than ideal firing position that is too far away, or if there's something with a mission to where you are so far away that you couldn't get closer due to whatever the terrain or whatever circumstances. So yeah, that's fine, but that's really specialized purposes, is those extreme long range precision rifle setups. And even there, like I said, you can, for $1,000, you get a decent rifle like a Tika T3 or something that's going to shoot straight. Or I've had an M77 Ruger that was $500 for a long time. That's kind of been my go-to rifle forever. 243 with a 10 power super sniper on it, less than $1,000, and you could do unbelievable things with that rifle if you practice.
Just another question that I was thinking as you were talking. For this scenario, like having to defend your land, your liberty, that sort of thing, what is something that people would get that would be like the quickest to get up, get down, get moving? Let's say there is an army coming in, you've got 20 guys over there, and it's just you and your family.
Your Minuteman rifle?
Yes.
That's a good question. Okay. What's the best Minuteman rifle? You know, an AR-15 probably does have its place. That does give you that added level of firepower if you do need to employ it. But that's like you said, in a Minuteman scenario, it's going to be more of a defensive deal. The thing with asymmetrical offensive warfare is you choose the time and place of your battle. So if you're going to be in a long, drawn-out, five-year-long war defending America from the Russians invading or from the Chinese invading, you can have a bolt action and choose the time and place of your battle, because there's going to be plenty of time to choose those places. If you are a Minuteman, that's a whole different set of criteria, because now you're in a defensive posture. You just got word that they're rolling in right now. You got like 10, you got a minute to get your poop in a group, and you don't know what's going to happen. You could be in a defensive scenario. You might need firepower backup to escape and evade, to disengage from combat, to break contact. So in those cases, you know, maybe a AR-15 is an excellent choice, because it's kind of the universal rifle. You got logistical compatibility with all the police and all the military. So you're going to have no shortage of ammo or magazines or parts with your fellow guys you're going to be shooting alongside with right there. And there'll probably be a lot of them laying on the ground at a certain point. So AR-15 is kind of the Gladius of today. That's not a bad option. Very accurate rifle, easy to handle, low recoil, a lot of ammo you can carry. So that's a great choice. Something with an optic, I would say, a low power optic, maybe a 4-power scope for those who can't afford something fancy. Like you can get a hunting power straight 4. That's plenty good for that cartridge. You don't need all this fancy tackle. If you got more coin, you can spend more coin and get a variable or a ACOG or an aim point or whatever. Aim point would be great. But an AR-15 with a low-powered optic or a red dot optic would be probably ideal for most applications for a Minuteman. Another thing that would actually be good is you want to have mixed in with your AR-15 guys, if it's more than one, a lightweight, probably precision rifle. Just a deer hunting rifle is totally good, because if you got guys rolling up the street, like the, who knows, they paratrooped into the town, and you got to be the Minuteman, right? Oh, crap. Well, you don't know what's going to happen. A lot of times an engagement's going to consist of a bunch of guys laying down cover fire so people can move around. Semi-automatic fire is usually to help you to move, to help the other guy. It loosens up your mobility. If you lay down cover fire, that's so that they put their heads down, they're not shooting at you. You are now able to flank them, to move, to retreat, to do whatever you need to do. But as far as the meat and potatoes of actually racking up the enemy kills, someone has to be aiming. So you're going to, a good mix of guys with bolt actions in there is going to be a great, that's going to be the money winner right there. They're going to actually be hitting the guys. So that's probably a good mix. AR-15, if you're all by yourself, maybe, but you're going to have the discipline not to get involved in a firefight that you're going to lose. You're going to have to aim one shot at a time. If you got that level of discipline, then an AR-15 is fine. If not, a bolt action deer rifle is going to give you a lot more power, a lot more penetration, a lot more surety that the target's going down, a lot more psychological effect, and you're going to have an extended range. You're going to be able to shoot at those guys way before they're going to be comfortable to defend themselves from you, because they're not going to even know where you're at if you're hiding behind a bush, or if you're hiding in some kind of window in some place. Who knows where you're at? So that's going to be incredibly effective. And you'd employ those FFP techniques we talked about in those circumstances if we were defending America from invading Russians or Chinese people. Or name your country. Who knows? Bad guys, right?
Yeah.
So as a Minuteman rifle, that's my advice there, I guess.
So this is one more quick question, and it might not be a quick question, but you say AR-15 in a lot of examples, and I'm just wondering why the AR-15 and not like an AK-47?
Okay, that's a very good question. If we were in Asia or Africa or even East Europe, the AK-47 would be a great choice because it is the current and long-time issued battle rifle of that area. We're talking about compatibility with other rifles, availability of ammo and parts. AR-15 is the current issued battle rifle of all your police departments in the United States. It's the current issue rifle of all the military since 1965. So for well over, 50 years now, the AR-15, or the M16, you know, same platform generally, same magazine, same ammo, has been widespread. It's the most popular selling rifle in America. There is a huge value to having logistical compatibility with other potential allies. Toss me a magazine. Oh, mercy, you have this goofy magazine. You have some kind of AR-10 Armalite that only takes this one mag. I don't have those. Well, that's probably wasn't your best choice because you are now limited only to your resupply. You got to resupply everything you got. And if you're running around and you don't know where you're going to relocate to, something that has logistical compatibility is a great choice. Likewise, if you're going to buy something new, in a bolt action, that's not big of a problem because 100 rounds goes a long time. That's going to last you weeks. You know, I mean, Carlos Hathcock doing patrols in Nama only carried 100 rounds at him at a time, and that was in the middle of enemy territory. So he wasn't carrying hundreds and hundreds of rounds like the infantry combat soldiers would. And if you got every guy in the whole squad carrying that many rounds, it's like a lot of ammo. But one guy who's aiming a rifle doesn't necessarily need that much. So the logistical compatibility is less of a factor when you're talking about a gun that doesn't require reloading as much, like a bolt action. Then you can have a 270 or a whatever goofy caliber that you might even have if you got enough ammo to kind of last through that engagement, which is probably 100 rounds or less, totally adequate. Because if you make it 100 rounds in a firefight with a bolt action, you probably won. You're probably doing pretty good. And I would think that somewhere in there you'd have the opportunity to get a hold of something else if you needed it. But in terms of semi-automatic rifles for defensive purposes for those other applications, AR-15 is the current issue rifle. You're going to find them everywhere. Every square inch is going to have something that'll feed that thing. So that's the main reason, logistical compatibility. And if people were looking for it, like something new, like, okay, so I'm going to buy a rifle and I'm going to learn how to shoot a bolt action, that's a thing you could consider too, is logistical compatibility in a bolt action. If you get a 308, you know, 7.62 millimeter or whatever, there's going to be the military designation of that. Or even a 223 rifle, maybe chambered hopefully in a 5.56. There are some like that. That's not a bad way to go because then you're going to be able to kind of use that ammo. It's not exactly perfect ammo. The military ammo, it might be a little tight in a civilian chamber, but at least you'll have the option of using military ammo in that rifle. And so ammo compatibility is a factor to consider as well. So I'd say 308, 223 are really good. Or if you're in a sporting area, like where there's a lot of hunters, and like if you're in Montana and you have a 30-06, you're covered because they're going to find that everywhere. Everyone and their dog has 30-06 ammo laying on the dash of their pickup truck. So you're not going to have any ammo shortage in those super common sporting rounds either if you're running a bolt action.
So at the end of the day there, Mr. Rex, the basic bare bones equipment that one would need for civil defense and the preservation of liberty isn't probably that high-end, real fancy equipment that everybody likes to look at on your YouTube channel. It's probably something a little more simple.
Actually, simple is probably a better way to go in a real circumstance. And that's, hunters will know this. You get all that junk strapped on your rifle, it's not mobile anymore. That's really for defending a static position, too. If you're going to sit up on top of a hill outside your ranch and defend it, and you have a special purpose rifle then, you have something that can reach out a mile, maybe, if you got a 338 Lapua Magnum or something. So it's a special purpose rifle. But for your universal Minuteman battle bolt action, a hunting rifle is an incredible setup. So I think that's a good way to go.
What about other than the rifle? What would somebody want to have on them as far as camouflage, as far as...
Oh, peripheral equipment. Very good you brought that up. I would have forgot. So aside the rifle, you know, a decent bolt action that's not damaged is going to do fine. You're going to want to have a reliable scope. that can be cheap. You can have a Simmons, you know, pronghorn on there, whatever. As long as it kind of stays sighted in, you're going to be able to reach out 300 meters. That's totally adequate. You're going to have a lightweight, handy rifle equipped with a scope that's going to get you plenty far out to do whatever you need to do in a combat deal, and that's going to be totally fine. So just a standard, typical hunting rifle with ammo. I would say you definitely want to have ammo. So if you're thinking about that, you're going to buy all this extra tackle, buy some ammunition, especially if you got a weird cartridge or something. Just buy enough to, like, as much as you can have. So ammo is probably your third deal you're going to want to have, right? Obviously, this rifle ain't worth anything without the ammo to feed it. Aside from that, you want a sling on your rifle so you can carry it, so you can carry other stuff. I would strongly recommend for those people who already have a deer rifle and they want to make it more effective, you need artificial support because you're going to have to just lay down anywhere at any time and maybe take a shot. And sometimes you can't get steady without if you're used to shooting from a bench or something, a bipod is an excellent artificial support system. So buy a Harris bipod, ultra lightweight hypod, I think is probably the just easiest way to go. They're everywhere. They're $100 for the swivel model. Get the swivel model, please. That's something I will be specific on because you're going to want to be able to adjust quickly on the fly. And for anyone who's wrestled with bipods that don't swivel, quickly, when there's an animal getting away, you're going to be canted all over the place. You can't get to get a swiveling bipod mounted on the front of there. The other thing you're going to need is maybe a couple pounds of beans in the bag that you buy, uncooked, the raw beans, like for bean soup. And you get a sock and you stick it in that sock and then you twist it and then you fold it over itself. Now you have a little bean bag. That's your toe support on your rifle. You don't want to use no monopods, all that junk ain't really going to work near as good as that. So get used to deploying your rifle from a bipod using toe support like a bean bag. So you use your left hand or your non-firing hand, whichever hand that might be, you put under the toe of the buttstock and you are dead solid. Now you and your deer rifle with your $3 to $9, $37 scope you got from Walmart that's zeroed because you zeroed it on paper and you made sure it's right. You zero at a max point blank range, 200, 300 meters, somewhere in there, depending on your cartridge, you know, like a deer hunter would zero a deer rifle. That's perfect for those applications. You got a bipod and toe support. You are deadly out to 300 meters for sure on small targets. Even like if they're just peeking around the corner, if the Chinese infantry guy's peeking out of his little armor personnel carrier, you're going to be totally lethal on a tiny target. You're going to be able to shoot him right in the lethal area, right in the no reflex zone at that kind of distance. You're just going to be steady, crank your little scope up to 9 power, aim right on the center, and you're going to be good. For a larger infantry defense type deals, you could reach out 500 yards easy. With a standard deer rifle, just be aware the bullet's going to drop a little bit. You know what I mean? You're not going to have the same level of precision as someone equipped with all the other stuff we talk about in the series. But that's, like I said, again, special purpose rifle in terms of actual employment into combat. Okay.
So like many of the discussions on here, it depends upon your application and also upon your experience level.
Yep. And I'd say 90% of the work you're going to ever need to do in one of these terrible scenarios that we're going over here would be totally best done with just a lightweight, streamlined, no tackle hanging off of it, deer rifle with a scope that works and artificial support, a bipod, beanbag for the toe support. And that's got you covered. Make sure you have enough ammo. Maybe one of those nylon bandolier ammo belts. Actually, it'd be good. You stick your ammo on there so it's easy to grab. Or you can fill your pockets with ammo. That's fine, just loose ammo. But you want to keep ammo readily available so you can reload on the fly. Actually, another thing you might want to have is a rattle can, a spray paint, the military spray paint you can buy for, I don't know if hunters use it or whatever, but it's like the olive drab and the military tans. You don't want to use the shiny stuff like they use for Christmas trees and stuff. But if your rifle's shiny, if you got a stainless steel rifle or if you've got a blued barrel that's real shiny, you're going to want to dull that out. So cover up those lenses or just remove the scope entirely, or you can get camouflage tape. Camouflage duct tape works amazingly well, or they sell the bow hunting tape. Just tape that thing up. Make sure it's not too shiny. That's the other deal. Camouflage. Absolutely. If you're in a rural environment, your camouflage is going to be like what a hunter would use. Actually, the hunting camouflage is superior in many ways to the military stuff. Some of the stuff they have for turkey hunting is unbelievable. So it just match your camouflage to your background, just like you would just kind of follow suit with what hunters do. urban camouflage is not going to be black BDUs. It's not going to be urban camouflage, and it's sure as hell not going to be some kind of military, like militia uniform. What you're going to want to have, if you're a good guy in the United States defending the homeland in a scenario like this, you don't want to be looking like a bad guy wearing one of those stupid uniforms. So what you're going to want to do is just wear your civilian clothes, because that is urban camouflage, because you are a civilian in a bunch of civilians. So you wear your Adidas sports jacket and your tennis shoes and your jeans or whatever you wear and your baseball cap. That would be your urban camouflage in the scenario we discussed of Red Dawn invading the United States.
Anything else with this whole preserving liberty, civil defense?
Yes, the thing you mentioned that I need to expound upon real quick. Whatever the heck you have, a deer rifle, if you can't shoot that thing, you're useless. Go out and shoot it. Spend some ammo. Go out to the range. What a lot of people think is a lot of shooting isn't really probably enough. You want to be able to just nonchalantly bring the rifle up and be able, if you're a good hunter, you're set. If you can hunt deer, you're already set. If you can hunt coyotes, you are set. You don't probably need to worry about it. If you can kill a deer, you're doing really good. So that's pretty much all of rural America is good to go. But if you're someone who's new to this whole deal, completely new, then you have to go out and shoot, and you have to shoot a lot. You have to get competent with that thing. You have to be able to, you want to be able to hit quarters at 100 yards with your deer rifle. That's totally within your capabilities once you practice the fundamentals. So learn how to shoot.
So I'm going to ask kind of a hard question, but how do you know when it's time to pull the trigger? As far as like defending your homeland and that sort of thing, like
that is probably the most difficult question to have. I mean, in civilian life here, I mean, you can only use a weapon in defensive applications when your life is in imminent danger. Otherwise, you're going to the slammer. So right now, in times of peace, you have to operate legally. You want to avoid danger at all costs. When I go for a walk with a wife, sometimes you go into a neighborhood where there's turkeys and they're wanting to cause trouble, and you see them from a block or two away. That's when you just walk down the other block. Yeah, of course I'm packing. I always pack. Been packing since I was a kid. You know what I mean? So, like, she does too, and it's, you just avoid the fight. So you don't want to shoot people if you don't have to. That's a terrible thing to have to do. And no one should be wagging their tail in this discussion either, probably. I don't think that, unless you're a psychopath or something, then that might be normal. But no, seriously. So if you're talking about defense of the homeland in a war scenario, like if we did get invaded, or if a tyrannical regime somehow infiltrated and took over the United States and you had to defend yourself against terrible bad guys, that's going to be, I don't even want to talk about it in a public scenario at this point, but it's something you're going to have to read the historical accounts of how it was done and where they won. Look at examples of how engagements were chosen by in the Revolutionary War against the British. That's a really good example. You'll read examples historically of what worked and what didn't work. You don't want to engage in symmetrical warfare with an overwhelming superior firepower force. You're going to lose. You're not going to fight helicopters and tanks. So you never engage a tank with your rifle when it's buttoned up. You're going to lose. So in those scenarios, you want to read examples of countries that have effectively employed what they call asymmetrical warfare, where they came out to where whoever was trying to get them left. That's the examples that are winning, and you can read how they chose to do it. There's a lot of books you can read about that, a lot of history books. That's where reading probably is going to help you. Watching movies, not so much. Movies compress time too much. They make people way too enthusiastic to start shooting. And I've noticed that too. Like when you're hanging out with certain people, like, oh yeah, they think of themselves as Rambo. It's like, dude, you don't need to run out there. You got all day. Like, you don't need to run out with guns blazing from the hip. That's a really stupid idea. You know what I mean? You can keep your head down. Let's have some patience here, because movies compress time. And so that's the wrong way to study for this scenario. Don't be watching American Sniper and watching Red Dawn even, or watching any of these stupid Hollywood movies thinking that that's a good way to practice for the scenario, because it's going to get you killed real quick.
Best way to practice would be to read a history book.
Yes, because that's a slow process that requires patience. So no, reading history books is always the way to go there. And like we said before, I mean, God forbid that stuff would ever actually happen. But, you know, it's the deterrent of it and people understanding their current potential capability to do that, to resist, and the confidence that those people would have, which deters it from happening, in the first place, which is why I think this is a valuable discussion to have, so that if people do equip themselves, it won't happen and we win without ever having to shoot anything. Because you really lose when you start shooting things.
And that should be also the other lesson to take away from reading a history book, is to try to learn something from it so we don't have to keep repeating these same mistakes.
Yeah, unfortunately, people haven't been reading too many history books. They've been watching sports and stuff and football and all this stuff that don't matter. And we've been lulled right down that path. That Austrian chick you're watching that video, Kitty, what was her name? I'll put the link in this podcast here. But very, very telling. You just look at examples in history of what not to do. And we pretty much failed most of them already. So we're approaching the ballot box. And some people even think that maybe after that, they're approaching the cartridge box. I hope that's not the case. But I mean, who knows what's going to go down?
These things are great to participate in, sports and fun things like that. But they're also a really great distraction.
Yeah, we can talk about that in a future podcast. That's about the distracted techniques of infiltrating communist regimes and getting the people so stupid they don't even know what's happening.
That's an entirely different
discussion. And then they can just have
their
way with you for 50 years, and then pretty soon you're just like a helpless little sheep rolled over on its side, and the wolves are all ready to dine on him. Brr, brr. Yeah, not a happy deal for the sheep, I'll tell you what. Wolves like that stuff, though, but...
That's why you need good sheepdogs, though.
Yeah, they do need good sheepdogs. So I'm assuming everyone listening to this is probably in that sheepdog category, because they're not what you would call a normal sheep type person, probably.
Probably
they're listening to this. If they made it all the way to the end of this conversation, you're already in that category. So just make sure you are a good person, that you're not too antsy to pull triggers. Only if your life is in imminent danger would you ever pull the trigger on anything. So that's the final word of the day on that conversation.
Well said, Mr. Rex. We're going to take a quick break here, ladies and gentlemen, and be back with another portion of today's Rex Reviews podcast.
That little round thing over there.